As we have seen in our previous discussions, our field, that is the domain of information technology in general, and information systems in particular, suffers from a very unique problem. The problem not known to other domains of engineering. Our inability to measure the work that we are doing. This problem has manifested in different ways, and from the beginning, all the attempts in our field has been only to solve this problem. If you see the history of our field, all the attempts done, or everything that you study in this field, is but an attempt to solve this problem. Let me recreate the history of our field for you from this perspective. Ideally, the question is this. There will be no argument if I say that the ultimate goal of our journey is to create good software. I think nobody will argue on this one. But the problem starts the moment you read this statement, in the sense, how will you quantify good? What is good software? That is where the whole problem starts. There are basically two approaches which people have taken to answer this question. One, you try to identify the characteristics of good software. Identify. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Easy to use. Satisfying all the requirements. Reliable. Scalable. Or more importantly, as they say in the textbooks, scalability. Or utilities. You make a list. Then you create a software. Then after you create a software, take the checklist and then start seeing, does this software satisfy this? Quality number 2, 3, 4, 5. If it satisfies, you will say it's a good software. This is one technique which we have followed. Quality checks, basically. That is, after you create the product, once the product is created, then you check it for quality. Imagine this is a path taken only in our field. For a moment, just consider what would have happened if other engineering domains would take the same path. You build the building, then make 10 people walk out. If the building is still standing, that means it's good. If it fails, again start building it. Is that the way they do? No. So the point is, in engineering domain, checking the quality of a product once it is manufactured is not acceptable. What is the more rational approach? Rational approach is, you identify a process which the people who are involved in making that product or writing the software have to follow. So, defining a process does not mean that you are guaranteeing something. Please understand. I don't say that if you follow this process model, a very good quality software will come. I am not guaranteeing that. But a small assurance that this is time tested. One, if you work in this way, something will come out. That has been the approach taken by all engineering domains. And in software also, people thought that they will take this path. Because path 1, that is identifying the characteristics of the product, does not seem to be good. Therefore, the other path. That is, define a process which every one of us will agree that this is the rational way of building software. And let people develop using that process. This has been the approach. In fact, if you see the 1969 that NATO conference on software engineering, the focus was this, to define a process for developing software. That is what they call it as software engineering. I'll come back to it later. What were the different process models and what were its limitations? But But basically, I understand again the stupidity of this approach. If you agree that writing software is more an art, a craft, rather than science, you will understand the problem in this whole path that we have taken. Let us compare the same thing with some activity which we generally consider belonging to the domain of art, say writing poetry. Our good friend is a poet. Or others who are involved in creative writing. Can we follow a very systematic process in writing something creatively? Can I say that morning 9 to 10, I will think about the basic idea. 10 to 11, I will start writing the basic sketch. 11 to 12, I will detail it in more fashion. 12 to 1, I will complete the words. 1 to 2, I will rest. 2 o'clock, I will get up, again see the words, do the quality check, redo it, and then by 3 o'clock, I will submit to the press. Is it possible to do that? Is it possible to measure, for example, the quality of a poet? How should we measure? Let us take the same thing what we do in software. Software, the basic benchmark for measuring anything is lines of code, right? Lines of code. Take the same thing to poetry. The efficiency of a programmer is measured using lines of code. Can we say that a good poet is the one who will write more lines of poetry on any human being? See how ridiculous the whole idea looks. Right? Or, for example, a painter. The number of strokes he made on the canvas. Can it be a measure? Can there be a unit of measure to define how efficient the painter is? See, we have to be very clear about writing. First, let us decide on this. Is software development an art, craft, or on the other side, a science? If we are not clear about this, the whole discussion which builds on this simply fails. It has been, it is, and it will remain my constant argument that software writing cannot be considered as an activity under the category of science. Mainly because, how do I define science as? Science is something, an act which is repeatable. Once you repeat the activity, you should get the same results. See, for example, Newton's ring, experiment. Whether I do the experiment in the prescribed way or you do that experiment, the results are same. That is science. Even if I drop apple or Newton drops the apple, apple will go down. That is science. What is science? Science removes that human component from an activity. Is it so in software development? If I write a program taking a specification and if you write this program using the same specification, is it guaranteed that both of the programs will look strikingly similar? No. I write the program as per my understanding of the problem and my knowledge base. You will make converse. So how can I, even for a moment, agree that software development is science? I cannot. Therefore, it has been my constant position that software development should ideally be considered as a work of art. The moment we decide on that one basic thing, our whole discussion takes a new shape. Now, if I consider that as an art, obvious questions will emerge. Why should you teach it to someone? Can someone teach? Can someone learn? Is it that we can train someone for 4 years and then make him a good software engineer? This is the same argument. Take someone to a music school. By the simple virtue of that person being in music school for 4 years, can we guarantee that he will be a musician? All these questions have to be getting to that new thing, we have done some means of sustenance. Therefore, we will simply come out of this group and just say that one of the parts here is that, see, first part is that you do the part. Second part is that you worry about the process. These two parts are there. In addition to these two parts, there is a third part which people have tried. That part is very interesting. See, the idea is you want good software, right? How do these two parts answer that question? The first effort is that you develop software in whatever way you want, but let it satisfy certain qualities. That is first answer. Second answer is, if you follow this process, you will get good software. That is second answer. What is the third answer? The third answer is, forget about everything. Good people will give you good software. It's a very interesting one. Instead of focusing on the process, why do we define the process? We define the process because we say that irrespective of who develops the software, if they follow this process, we are guaranteed that we will get some level of quality, good quality software. That is the argument. The argument here is exactly opposite. Here we are saying that you focus on people component. Good people will automatically write good software. This is the third approach that we are taking. So along the history of computing, these three attempts have been tried in various ways. We worried about good quality product. Software is today. The good quality software has an ISO standard. What is ISO basically? Basically, if anything, if it has an ISO process model, that means that it is quantified, it is measured, and it is ready now. You can have a checklist and say whether it is good or not. That means we have taken care of first part. The second part, all of you know, right? Various process models has been considered. In fact, if you just sit for a moment and think, what is the logic behind the SEI, that is Software Engineering Institute's CMM and PCMM? What somebody did? It is exactly this. What somebody initially believed that if you define a process, you should be getting good software. Therefore, he defined CMM, capability, maturity, model. What is that? There are five levels. In each five level, there are key process areas. If any organization satisfies these process areas, that means it has a certain level of maturity. Right? The focus is on process. After a while, I think he understood the limitations of his thinking. And he came up with one more way of solving this problem. Path was PCMM. People, capability, maturity, model, where the focus was not on the process, the drive, inhuman process, but something which understood, recognized the human component in software development. So these both approaches are there in software. We today don't know actually. If you ask me very frankly, we don't know how software gets done, why some software gets very successful, why the software fails. We don't know. We are still in the process of understanding the whole thing. That is why there is a whole lot of avenues for doing research. For example, my focus in this whole discussion is to understand one fundamental question. Generally, how is software developed in an industry? Generally. To understand this, I have to ask you one basic question. All of you, in various levels, have been involved in developing some software of some scale. Forget software, a small program, or a mid-level program. All of you have written, well, on your own. If I ask you one fundamental question, can you tell me in very concrete terms the process that you have followed? You have studied various process models, development, methodologies. If I ask you the question, do you consciously think that you have to follow A, waterfall approach, B, spiral model, 3, incremental model? What would be your answer? We know. Does anybody, if he has a problem before it, does he start thinking, okay, can I solve it using waterfall? No, right? None of them. Believe me, no one does. Not only you. Even industries don't think like this. Then why do we need all these development models? Is there a need? Aren't they artificial? That may be the question. Unfortunately, again, in an industry kind of an environment, if you don't document the process, the whole foundations on which the business of software is to be standing on, how will you pay the salary? How do you know somebody has worked, somebody has not worked? These questions have to be answered, right? So there should be some definition. There is some team leader, there is some project leader, there is some business analyst, there are programmers. You need that. Until you don't have those kinds of things, how can you run business? Unfortunately, we don't understand this, but still we have to follow. So in industry, they have very clear models. In fact, I have this point to make. Royce, who is the man who defined what we today call as waterfall model, he never called it a waterfall model. If you see his original paper, which was published in 1970, he never used the term waterfall model.
Nobody knew what was happening. But at the end,
prepare a very neat documentation saying that person 1, person 2 was doing requirements, person 3, person 4 was doing business. Let us be honest, everyone does this. Because we all understand that there cannot be a very clear definition on these terms. We are not machines. We are not machines. See, for example, the one question which we keep asking during the project in seminars is that very specifically tell me what is your contribution to this project. It's a common question asked. If you say requirement, then what did you do after requirement? The teacher is very angry and says, who is leaving after you teach the requirement? Unfortunately, we all forget that it is simply not possible to work like machines. Machines can work like that. They do their part, keep quiet, they give it to the next part of the machine, they will continue the work, go to the next part. We can't work like that. I can't see my friend struggling, doing something, I will go there, help him more. Right? That always happens. Meaning, I have now come to a stage where I am making a very controversial statement of rejecting all process models in software engineering. Why? Because we have worked for the last 30-40 years. If you take 1970 as the benchmark year of where Royce introduced his waterfall model, till now, 2010, 40 years have passed. Countless methodologies have come. We said rational unified process, object-oriented modeling. At one point of time, we all believed that yes, now everything is clear. Because everything is objects. One of the advantages and attractions of object orientation was that you define everything as an object. It's a very clear deployment model there. So people can say very clearly what they are doing. We all believed in it. Then they said ego-less programming. For a moment we believed that ego-less programming is the way forward. Then came all these extreme programming and other things. What are we doing today? Even after 40 years, we are still saying that there is a software crisis. So what should we do? I think two or three areas, we promised many things, nothing happened. Yesterday, Professor Ramakrishnan from IAC was here to inaugurate the image processing workshop. He made a very honest confession. I really liked it. The confession was this. He is an extremely well-known processor in signal processing, voice recognition. He made a statement which most of the researchers won't mean, that voice recognition research has betrayed the beliefs the community had on. We haven't achieved anything in voice recognition. Till today, after so many years of research and billions of dollars spent on voice recognition, we don't have a decent enough voice recognition system. The basic problems there are this, as he rightly observed. One is, one software which can work for one language cannot work for another language. That is the problem in India today, no? We never use one language. We mix up languages. When I speak, I mix English and Kannada and sometimes many other languages also. It's a practical reality. Software cannot understand that anymore. We are nowhere close. The dragon speech, if anybody has used, how effective is it? At least for Indian purposes, it has never worked. That he, I was very happy that yesterday he agreed that the research has really not happened, not met the standard. There is one more area on which I am very critical, artificial intelligence. If you see artificial intelligence, I keep telling this to people, whatever was promised by these researchers, by the community as a whole from our side, we have never kept those promises. From 1960s when artificial intelligence started till now, what have we done? We haven't done anything. And third area is software process methodology. These three areas, we never kept up the promise. Something has to be done. And I was thinking about this. And suddenly I found that there is something happening somewhere we are not recognizing. Free and open source software. All the software development, see, I am not critical. People say that I am critical about Windows. I am not critical. I am just making a point. Very honestly tell me, Windows 95 came. Right? You are not using Windows 95. We didn't know anything about Windows 95. Windows 95 came in 95-96. It was introduced in India in 96. Before that, we were using Windows 3.1. If anybody has installed it using a set of floppies, I have done that. Windows 3.1 had to be installed using a set of floppies. 8 or 10, if I remember correctly. We had to keep on inserting one floppy after other. Windows 3.1, Windows 95, 98, and the batches, list of batches for 98, 2000, XP. Supposedly, I have seen the screenshots of Windows 7. What is the progress? What is it that we have achieved? Compare Windows 95 and Windows XP. Is there a paradigm shift in the way we are using computers? Have we done something radical in these 10-15 years in computing? No. After graphical user interface, it is stagnant. What happened after? Once there was command-based interface, DOS. After that came graphical user interface. Fine. There was a paradigm shift. After that, what next? We don't know. The touchscreen has not entered the mainstream. So the basic computing interface has not changed from about 15-20 years. In so-called IT industry, which is moving at a very fast pace. Why is this? You should understand the root cause for this problem. Problem I tell you.